What is going on, everybody? Welcome back to episode 49 of Debate and Destroy with yours truly, Blackout Bill, joined with my co-host, as always, the fiend from Corizo Springs,
Local JJ.
Motherfucking JJ Del Toro's in the house.
That's right.
And we are happy to have our brother in metal back, the man, the myth, the legend, Death Metal Hagrid himself, Stefan Ortega. Lead singer of Imminent Descent. The howler, the screamer, the legend, right, with his beautiful, soft, delicate voice. Yes.
I can't help it, man. We all can't sound like fucking soccer announcers, okay?
years of practice, dude. Years of practice. And today's episode, big change up. Never gone this direction. Nah. Does it, Djent? Today it does. Today it does. As Stefan picked the albums, Born of Osiris, The New Reign versus After the Burial, Rareform. And Stefan, let the people know why these two albums, why this debate.
Well, dude, honestly, okay. Djent came around as a form of deathcore and metalcore. And I remember hearing the term and being like, what the fuck do you mean, Djent? Like, Djent is the D is silent, like Django. And I picked these two albums because these were some of the first like pioneers of it. They were Djent before Djent was Djent, you know, for real. But like later on, bands like Periphery came along and it's like clearly the fucking
That's the main focus of it.
You know, like these were one of the first these are some of the first bands to just rip off Meshuggah. No,
well, it's true. It's true. It is a joke, but it's also true. But they did it like in their own way.
Exactly. You know
what I mean? Meshuggah always to me were like, it's Djent, but it's just like for some reason Meshuggah just gives me like they don't fit in with the other bands that came around later.
Yeah,
I think it's because of the production, because you know, Destroy Race Improve, Chaos Sphere, and is it Catch 33 or what's the one after that? The one after that, I'm sure I can't remember the one with like Rational Gaze and stuff. Nothing. Oh, those three, okay. They still had the production of like the 90s, or where it sounds a little bit less like digital, a little bit like more raw, where like it didn't really make it Djent for me until this type of production came along. You know, like that Periphery where you really get the, like,
it's clear. That's the main use. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's why I like these two albums, man. Like, I really love them because it's not overused. I do like Djent. I do. But sometimes some songs just go full on. Like,
Periphery, I think we'll argue about that.
I can't get into it so much.
I think there's a couple songs in here where it's like,
it's too much for
like
you?
Towards the end of the album. But for me, these albums don't overstay their welcome because they're really short. They're only eight songs, which I love. So it's not
straight
a big deal.
To the point.
But for me, like, and we'll talk about it later, but After the Burial, for like on their side, it's a little bit less of just the constant breakdown. They have like some of that Inflames, like guitar melody.
They have a
stuff,
lot of melody.
Whereas like the Born of Osiris is just like, let's just breakdown, which is fine.
But I read that drummer, he's the one that wrote the music, and he was like really young when he did it. I think he was like 16, 17 when he wrote it.
The drummer, that's Cameron Loesch.
Yeah, he's the one that wrote the album.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, because this is technically their first, right?
Yeah. This was their debut, and this was just kind of a shape, like, a new sound that obviously they would mature. And after this album, for people that haven't listened to it, their album, The Discovery is one of, I think, where they come into their own. And I think that's their masterpiece. Mm-hmm. But this was like the first flash of brilliance, you know, the first the one that started it.
Yeah.
So this EP, or this first release, is it your favorite Born of Osiris? Or you said The Discovery is like their magnum opus?
Yeah. I would say The Discovery is definitely hands down, because they had Jason Richardson playing guitar. And Jason Richardson, he played with All Shall Perish at one point, which All Shall Perish, great fucking band. He ended up going on to play with Chelsea Grin at one point and made their shit way better, like terrible. And his solo shit, if you ever get a chance to listen to Jason Richardson's solo shit, incredible. So I believe for one album, Born of Osiris had Jason Richardson on guitar, and that was 2011's Discovery. Like, that album is them, I think, at top tier. Afterwards, they put out some good shit, but that album
is like
their
top tier. What about After the Burial? Because for me, like, I think before, we were talking beforehand, I had never heard these bands, because for me, like, when I had heard them. The first time I heard them was live.
Yeah.
And I was at a point here, like in high school, where I was just being like an elitist. I didn't give them a real chance. Hate breakdowns. Fucking hate these bands. Where's Megadeth? Where's Megadeth? Where's Megadeth?
Exactly. I was the same boat.
And I remember, honestly, the first time I saw, I think it was after the burial. It was a show with them, Upon a Burning Body, Veil of Maya, and someone else.
Oh, that was a show. Wow, shit. All right.
And I remember volumes. Us being volumes. And I remember being so irritated because they would break down so much. I would just start holding my finger up for like what breakdown they were on. I'm like, one, two. I'd be like, you hit six breakdowns in one song? It's been three goddamn minutes. Like,
I mean, you gotta admit, that show was fucking wild. The singers were like on the roof.
I know. And that's the thing, too. Looking back, like, those shows were fucking nuts.
Yeah,
like,
they were.
Well, and of course, because the Bottom Burning Body's from San Antonio, so, like, the fucking place went crazy. But this was the first time I gave them a genuine listen back, and I just was like, all right, let me clear impressed. My mind of the stigma of the Djent stigma, of any kind of stigma. Let me just have an open mind. And I'm like I said, I'm glad you recommended it because, dude, there's some fucking bangers on here. Yep. They got riffs.
And just to clarify, we both, or all of us, we listen to the remastered versions.
Yeah, yes. So we, obviously there's the new Reign and Rareform. I listen to them both, but we're going to talk about the Eternal Reign versus the Rareform re-release.
Because big difference.
Those are the better versions. Yeah. I think.
Because whenever you listen to the two, you listen to obviously the new Reign versus the Eternal Reign. It's just night and day, the production. I mean, the songs are obviously the exact same, like I think down to the minute and everything. Mm-hmm. But honestly, the Eternal Reign, whenever you listen to it, they remastered it in 2017, that it's just so much better. I mean, the vocals are just clearer. Everything is just more polished.
Yeah.
And exactly. Like, and there's certain not, that's not always a good thing in certain cases. Whenever bands remaster their
In Flames.
Yeah. Like fucking
leave them alone. Leave them alone.
All right, we've hit a fucking hot spot. But yeah, in this instance, the. It's after hearing the Eternal Reign, it's really hard to go back to listening to the new Reign because everything you could just hear, like you could just hear everything. It's like listening to shit like on some shitty old Samsung headphones.
Very true.
And listening to them on beats, you're like, oh, I can hear it all.
Yeah. Very fucking so true. And when I went and did like, I did the new Reign first. And I was just like, the first comment was like, oh my fucking God, this production is
garbage.
Yeah,
he texted me, he's like, this
I was
is
like,
so
dude,
bad.
These drums so bad. I can't even fucking listen, like they're so bad. And it's a sad thing because Michael Keane from The Faceless was the producer, which is crazy.
Right?
But yeah, like you said, the re-release is just significantly better. But sorry, and I cut you off. I asked a question. I didn't even let you respond. For After the Burial, is this your favorite album from them or is it... Is it their magnum opus? Because I haven't looked. This is the first thing I've heard from them.
You know, it would be hard for me to choose my favorite after this. This one, I'm biased because this is just the album that got me into them, that I saw live and that I've loved from the start. But in my opinion, they haven't put out a bad release, you know, and it wasn't actually until recently we saw them with a Killswitch, you know, that got me back
into them. Yeah, because that new single, Evergreen, with I remember just like, we were there, I think, together. And I just remember like, well, this is our new song. I'm like, all right, well, let me check it out. Because I had just pulled up with my nephew. And all those squealies. Oh, my God, dude. I was just sitting there like, God damn, After the Burial can fucking
That's
play.
That's awesome.
And it was, and it's just the fact that it was like, obviously, just one guitarist live. Behold the Crown is the crown. That riff is just, it's such a trippy fucking riff, and it's really impressive that it's been obviously about 12 years since this album came out, since Rareform
came out.
Just
crazy to think about.
Yeah, but that they're still kind of coming off of with these riffs that are just like, that is a weird fucking riff.
Very unique. Some of these are unique.
Yeah,
exactly. You just don't hear shit like that, you know? And so it's good that they've been doing that since 2006, you know, putting out these weird fucking riffs, and 14 years later, they're still finding ways to come out with these riffs. It's like, this is fucking weird, but I love it, you know?
Yeah, if it's a smacker, it smacks.
Yeah, that's right.
Anyway, with that all being said, we gotta start this bitch off.
Let's go.
Start this bitch off. Dude, track number one, Rosecrance?
That's what I said. I don't know.
Yeah, Rosecrance.
Rosecrance versus Berzerker.
Dang. Shit. Both start hard, dude.
Nah, dude, I'm sorry. This what? Is an easy one.
No, it's not.
This is so easy,
no,
bro.
No, you're like, crazy,
you
dude.
Are not going to tell me Rosecrance is better than Berzerker. There's no
both
way.
Both are awesome. You're crazy one, to think okay. about.
We can start with whatever one.
Rosecrance starts for
I think this one's a blow. There's some close ones.
Oh, my God.
JJ, there's some close ones. This one ain't close,
which one are we starting off on?
Rosecrance, since he's such a big hater already.
I'm not a hater. I'm not a hater. It's a good song, dude. Like, it's
has good melody.
Gets to the point.
Yes.
Breakdown after breakdown. I love the way they start. And they start a lot of songs like this.
You said you love the way you start. It starts. Oh, but you like Berzerker better?
Berzerker as a full song? Gosh. It's not even close, dude. Like,
come on.
Like, this one is just like, let's show off how many breakdowns we can do, how fucking extreme it is. I like it. Like, it's badass. The drumming is sick. It's very relentless. My thing is that, I don't know. It's not that I don't like Rosecrance. It's just that Berzerker as like a whole song is just significantly better. Like, you cannot tell me it's not better.
It's structured really well. Both of them are awesome, man. But Rosecrance just goes in hard, man.
That is a hype-ass intro, man. Yes. That is a hype-ass intro.
Okay, and Berzerker's their biggest song or one of their biggest songs?
One of them. I know that they still throw that into rotation along with Aspiration is something that they'll close with Aspiration typically. But yeah, like Rosecrance, that intro is just the like it's
just ferocious.
Like, oh, shit. Like,
yeah.
It's
ferocious.
It's hard not to get hyped.
I understand that.
Yeah,
I definitely understand that.
And it is. I understand. It is literally a third as long as short as Berzerker.
Yeah.
Berzerker
yeah.
is literally three. They had three times as long to kick ass.
That's true. So, and I don't think they like, because there's other songs on the After the Burial side where I think they're too long. Like, they could have shortened the
song.
They
could have trimmed some of the fat.
But this one is like, it's a great time. You know, it's just constantly entertaining you. It's fucking got like great changes. The guitar, the harmonized guitar work, and I'll keep talking about that with After the Burial.
Oh, yeah.
I fucking love that stuff. Yeah. Like, it sounds so good. But with Rosecrance, I was going to tell you this. There's a side of like math rock or math metal to Born of Osiris, right? Like, am I the only one to mix that up?
No,
like a kind
no,
of like
I
a Dillinger
that,
Escape mixed with the Djent? Because some of the breakdowns are like, whoa, what?
Honestly, like Cameron Loesch, like him as a drummer, some of the shit that he does, like, it's just like, what is he doing?
Yeah, it's definitely hard to like keep up. And there's a lot going on. They do so much with so little time. And those riffs do sound more unique, right? But, I don't know, dude. Like I said, it's just not better than Berserk. Like,
Berserker has great melody, has great transitions, and great breakdowns, dude. It really does.
Really, one more thing about Rosecrance before we move on to Berserker. It's just that it's only a 2-minute song.
Exactly. It gets to the point.
And they happen to to fit two breakdowns within those 2 minutes. And that is an impressive ratio. Okay? A breakdown per minute? Who
dude,
else
that's
does
hard.
That?
Just them, dude.
Yeah. But yeah, no, that's the case for Rosecrance, I understand. We could totally move on to Berzerker.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like it's a very quick,
my gosh,
like taste of what you're about to get on this album. Like,
yeah,
just
exactly.
Fucking Breakdown City, crazy, crazy timing. The drumming's like awesome.
Yeah,
but it's like it's just very short, and that's not. I'm not dogging it for that.
Yeah,
but just
yeah.
like for me, if we switch over to Berzerker, the way, like. It's just a more complete song to me, personally. Like, I don't know how else to explain that. Like, it just comes off like a better, more well-rounded song. I love the guitar work a little bit more because I think it's catchier. Like, it's not just like there to say, oh, we're so banging or so fast. They actually have something to say.
Yeah.
I mean, that's obviously all of this is my own personal opinion. But I just thought, and I'm a sucker, once again, and I'll bring this up over and over. You guys know I love In Flames. I love Mellow Death. So, like, those types of riffs, my ear obviously like catches better.
Yeah.
Because you know, you get that ding 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 ding.
No, they have some good
melody. I'm like skipping
exactly.
around. Like, oh, I like that. I like that. All right, what's that? Bring that back. But
surprisingly for me, the star of the show was a vocalist. So what's his name? That dude killed it on this song, dude.
Fucking
I don't know his name.
Grant's Lumina. He was the. Oh no, that's the original. Sorry, the 2009 is Anthony. I can't say his last name. No, Notarmeso.
I don't know, dude. But this guy fucking murdered on this song, dude. And the screams at the end. Oh my god, that guy's a freaking nature. I really like this vocals.
And there's like two guest appearances. We'll talk about on. I didn't even know that.
Like
on the next songs.
But
yeah, man, he does a great job. And you were telling us, and this is so true, on the original EP, I didn't think the vocals were as up to par with this. Like. This second screamer they got for the re-release of Rareform is just fucking, he demolishes it. It sounds good. Like you said, the attack on like that, like that pig squealer scream. I don't know how you call that, but Yeah. It fucking just sounds awesome, man. But
let me see. What's his name? Yeah, Anthony. Let's just call him Anthony.
Anthony.
Not Armasso.
Not Armasso. Yeah,
I remember. Okay, I think I saw After the Burial for the first time probably it was a Thrash and Burn tour, which is either 2007, 2008, probably 2008. I have a shirt put away that has them. But yeah. I remember seeing, and it was with their original vocalist, and that's how I became a fan. And then he left, and they got Anthony, and around 2010, because the next album features Anthony on vocals. And I remember seeing them for the first time, and afterwards, like, going up to him and being like, dude, you are the best fucking thing that could have happened to this band, because his range is all over the place.
Yeah,
if you listen to the original, the OG Rareform, the vocals are a lot more linear, and the old singer just does not hit the highs nearly as well, whereas Anthony is a master. His range,
you get a good roller coaster
really,
on this song.
Yeah, right? For sure. Mm-hmm. For sure. So I agree 100%. Like, his vocals are really, really impressive.
Yeah, I was
and
really
I
impressed.
Did look up, but did the original singer write the lyrics for this, or did the lyrics come from Trent? I don't know. I didn't look that up.
Honestly, I did notice that.
Because that's something I was going to bring up, is I definitely prefer the lyrics on Rareform. Like, some of them I actually thoroughly enjoyed versus the Born of Osiris ones I was like okay with, but Berzerker not specifically, but I was just wondering. I didn't know who wrote the lyrics or if you knew.
As I was I used AZ Lyrics to look up the lyrics. Uh-huh. Like, almost all of them, it was some Dream Theater shit, because like Trent wrote like all of them. Like,
really?
you know, like James LeBrae, whenever you look at how many songs that James LeBrae has fucking written, it's like none of them.
Yeah,
like,
it's all John. Yeah. Petrucci, right? Exactly. Portnoy, I think, did a lot of that too.
That's why I say some Dream Theater shit, because it was like Trent.
He's got
writing.
Some blackmail on them or something, dude.
Damn,
why is
I didn't
he in
know.
The band?
I can try to look it up while we talk.
Yeah, no, but most of them were written by Trent. Is what I'm saying.
That's
it's like
cool.
Eight songs. I would probably say at least six or seven of them were written by the guitars.
That's
so
impressive.
He's clearly the heart of this band.
Yeah,
if we're being honest, you know.
That's cool, man.
Yeah.
All tracks. Oh, they don't separate it out on here, but it says all tracks are written by Grant, Trent, Justin, and Lee. So
yeah,
Grant. I guess he did contribute, although it doesn't tell us how many lyrics he wrote. But either way, the lyrics were good. It's kind of a point.
Besides that, dude, I don't know how you think this is easy. I think this was hard, but picking one, this is really a toss up. But As much as I love Rosecrance, I think Berzerker's better.
Thank you. I was about to get so hot. You have no idea. I'm going Berzerker.
Yeah, yeah. Can we play 245?
Just to clarify the win.
Just to let everyone know. Sure. 245 on Berzerker. Let me do it. Give me 1 second. I don't want to. On one of the episodes, I was sort of novice and I blasted our listeners' ears.
Just destroyed
me to do that. You said 234?
245, and it's just because of how fucking weird these breakdowns are. Obviously, breakdowns can be a dime a dozen, but one of the things that separates After the Burial is their groovy ass fuck. Like, they're so groovy.
This breakdown, I wrote down too, and I put, this is Pantera Djent. That's what it reminded me of. I'm going to put it on. Oh, come on. We're the cowboys from hell!
Oh, man. The only thing I miss about the old one is the... Like, they added to it, but this one doesn't have the O, but it's still sick.
That part right there.
Oh, that's God.
That's butter.
I can only take so much. No,
I know.
But yeah, no, it's so hype. The, you know, the just the lyrics. That's honestly the perfect workout song. Like, if you know, the mighty one, remember why your skin is so thick. Like, you're just like, yeah, my skin is thick, motherfucker. You know, like, oh, I don't feel pain, you know.
Step on it, Rareform. No, but the only thing I would say that I would take away from Berzerker is that 413 riff. I don't like that riffing style. That one where it's just like, chung. Yeah. Where bands do that?
No, that's what I'm saying. They don't overuse it.
They don't, but it's not my favorite riff.
Because this is a mesh of what? What do you think? Of deathcore, metalcore, and djent?
And groove.
All groove, all that meshed riff together.
Is like fucking djent mixed with groove. And that's something that I wrote down where I was like, that's something After the Burial made unique. Because it's my thing is like, dude, if you're going to rip off Meshuggah, fine, but add your own twist. And that is adding your own twist. Because I can't name, right now off the top of my head, I cannot name another band that mixes that like djenty groove. Like, that's a very unique mixing, right?
Genres. For sure. And honestly, I listen to more djent than I would care to admit. Like, I know it's a semi guilty pleasure, but I like volumes, even though some of they have a song called Wormholes where the entire fucking riff is djent. I always thought that was weird because I was like, oh, you play guitar, sweet, show me something, and you were just like djent. You'd be like,
Got anything else?
Oh yeah, I also like where that song originated. Deftones. Like,
that's insane.
Sweet.
Dude.
Those are the. That's your style. God. Sweet. Yeah.
Go ahead. Go for it.
How are you gonna get laid? You know.
I know.
Bring a girl back to your house and then being like, check out this song.
Those two notes are killer.
It's called Wormholes.
I always laugh because if there's volume fans out there, I'm sorry, but I tease volumes because I remember the time we saw them live and they had two screamers. I just could not tell the difference from like the two screamers. I'm like, what's the difference? Like,
okay, yeah,
like, come on, can one of us give me some melody? One gives the high. No, dude, they're both just nasally like.
Honestly, one of them that I remember, honestly, it's not, their tones are not very different. And I did wonder why they needed two. They did lose one of the vote. Right now, the current lineup, they have Mike Terry, who used to play for Bury Your Dead in 2009's album, It's Nothing Personal, which is a great fucking album. But now, backing up a little bit, before they used to have Volumes has some clean songs with some clean vocals in it.
Mm-hmm.
But neither of the vocalists sing. So they had so they would play these songs live and it would be on a backing track.
That's so whack.
So there was one time though, whenever Born of Volumes was touring in the keyboardist from Born of Osiris, Joe Burris, toured with Volumes as the second vocalist, and it was such a special moment because Joe, the keyboardist from fucking Born of Osiris, can actually fucking sing.
Yeah.
Oh my god, there's actually being sung live. But either way, they have Mike Terry. He's this fucking dope ass African American gentleman who actually can hit all the notes that are required in Volumes. So now Volumes is a pretty decent band, but live band before without even being able to. Why did they have two vocalists?
I don't know. I remember we talked about that on the show. We're like,
they gotta have been friends or something.
They're probably just friends. But then it's like a certain point, the guitarist is just definitely like, all right, guys, I know we're boys, but hey, here's a stick. Whoever dies.
I mean, this comes from a Volumes fan. They didn't need two vocalists back then. Now they do, but back then they didn't need two fucking vocalists. Why?
All right, guys. Berzerker gets the pentagram of truth. Yeah, let's move on to track number two. Empires Erased versus Drifts.
I thought this one's a little easier, actually.
What?
Dude, we're off today.
I want to know why it's easy.
No, I said it's easier.
We're doing Empires.
Whatever you guys want to start with.
I was going to start with Empire, but that intro riff for Empires, that is like very, very djent. Like that is.
Yeah.
Like,
but then at 26 seconds, it's transitions and woo, it's powerful stuff, man.
Exactly. I was going to say that like isolated transition with the, like it stops on the harmonics. That's a great trick. And they use it a couple times and I really like it.
Yeah.
My problem is I really want to know, because have we seen Born of Osiris?
Yes, we saw in Mayhem.
Fuck, I don't remember.
Those was Bodom when they released Halo of Blood.
Okay, my question is for you, because they're really tight on the album with being like hitting those squealies at the stops. Can they really do that live? Because that's fucking impressive.
Yeah, the only okay, like, I've seen Born of Osiris live, like, fucking probably a good 6-8 times.
Damn.
And it's always a good live show. The only thing is sometimes I'm hesitant to, like, if a band needs a laptop to perform their entire set, you know, like
that's
there
weird.
there was one time when the laptop collapsed or it knocked over and they made it into a really funny moment where all of them were like, fuck, you know, like, but it's like, yeah, they need a laptop.
See, for
intros, so, like, or what? The Skeleton Witch did that in Austin. They use an iPod for the intro. Remember that shit?
Like, it's like different than a Mac. But like, I think my question is, if on their backing track, they're putting like some of those guitar parts, because like in the moment, hitting a squealy like exactly dead on a transition part could be really fucking hard. So like, I really want to know how much is attributed to the back track. Because I remember, I think I talked to Justin about this, about that Canadian tech death band.
That really fast one.
Yeah, they did Relentless Mutation, Archspire.
There you go.
I was like, I saw them and I like didn't believe it. Like I was just like, something's up. Like I just don't buy it. Like, I don't know how you could be that quick, but maybe I'm just not that good of a musician. I don't know.
I don't know, dude.
Archspire, they are fucking mutants. I've seen Archspire before, and that's some crazy shit. Like, especially that's the shotgun vocals, but I'll go into a whole tangent.
Yeah,
but with
Born, so when the laptop collapsed, did they bring it back and they resurrected the show, or did they perform without the laptop?
No, they needed to bring the laptop back. So Ronnie, their vocalist, did you know, I guess they had to restart or something, but
I mean,
honestly, Born of Osiris really does. They do have an immaculate live show, and I think that's one of the, you have to have an immaculate live show in order to make it in this climate, you know. So that they're honestly, I think they're a great live band who do pull it off, because I have indeed seen some bands such as Volumes where you're like, they need the fucking the backing track to do certain parts, and you're like, so you literally couldn't do this part without a laptop. So
yeah, my big thing too is like, when they do backing tracks of like vocals, I'm like, seriously, no one in the band can do backup vocals? That should drive, like in flames does it all the time, where it's just like,
yeah,
Anders will be screaming along with a backing track for that like melody. I'm like, dude, Bjorn, just fucking scream or do something. Like, can someone do something?
I'm totally asking
too much, but that's when, like, when bands actually do it, then you're like, you respect the living shit out of them, because you know how much harder it is to do that without a backing
track.
Maybe
sometimes backing is better. Like, just, okay, prime example, Avenged Sevenfold. None of those guys can do backups.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Their backups are bad.
So like, might as well get the backup.
Jesus Christ. Zachy, I love his guitar playing, but him and Johnny Christ, they have like some of the worst backups.
Sometimes
ever.
Necessary. I would agree that sometimes
for the
necessary
sake of
to have.
The show.
Yes, exactly.
You know, I don't really want to name the band because they're good. Let's just say they're here from San Antonio, and we've talked about them before. But the main vocalist mic did not work. Like, I don't know. That it just seemed like a rookie move.
I think I know what show you're talking about. So the
main vocalist mic he didn't do a check before, so it didn't come on. And all you hear is the backing track.
And like, I remember fucking show, dude. Yeah. I will name the band, but I know what you're talking about.
Was I there?
You were there, yeah.
We'll talk about it after this. We're not trying to shame anybody right now.
But I think the same thing happened to me, and I will name the band because In Flames, you're not going to take them down. They're legends. They're gods to me. Like, they're awesome. But it's the same thing when we were at the River City Rock Fest.
Oh, yeah. Dude,
and they kept going down, out, but you hear the backing track.
Yeah.
And you're like, that sucks. At least for them, it's like vocals and samples, but it's not, Anders is still screaming over it, but it's still like, you know, I guess it adds, but anyway, we're going way off track. I'm going to bring up on Empires Erased. Dude, this riff at 25 seconds, I just had to bring it up, dude. It's just too much,
JJ.
Dude, I like
that they finally bring in the keyboard. That's nice. I like the keyboard.
I like it,
yeah.
But there's other songs where, boy, I tell you what.
Oh, man, the hot takes.
The hot takes coming from Bill today. Well, let me bring this up to speed.
25 seconds.
I love both those transitions.
That's good stuff.
See, for me, that was the like the best chorus on the album.
Yeah.
I loved it because they do that like That from the Djent part, that transition into that riff I just put on, I loved it because that nice little guitar sweep and then that smooth transition to the chorus. And I love that melody scream behind the guitar. I was like, why don't they do that more often? Like, that chorus is really good. Like, and there's some of the courses where they try it and they just don't hit, but they probably do later on. This is their first release, well, so yeah, I'm sure they get better at it.
And that's one of the things that's better about that they improved upon in the Eternal Return is they actually have layered vocals and they have Joe. Having the harmonies and whatnot, whereas they didn't get to that point until like the Discovery, and that's what makes the Discovery such a good album later on is that they incorporate Joe, their keyboardist, a lot more because that motherfucker is like talented.
Yeah, exactly. He's, I really like his, and they don't like, they have him set in this Eternal Reign, they have him set in the mix really well, where it's not like, oh, I'm glad that the scream is more the forefront because it's really aggressive music, but it's just back there enough where he's really highlighting that melody. So, and it goes along well with the keys, like in an atmospheric sense, but I really enjoyed that. That was my favorite chorus, I think.
No, I really like this song. And then going to Drift.
It's killer, yeah.
Drift. Oh, 1 second. Just,
oh, no, go ahead. Yeah.
Oh, just really quick. Empire Erase. Like the fucking...
Yeah. No. As we're talking about, first off, just the main, the title, just the my favorite part of the song is the whatever. Yes. That is the Empire.
Dude, like, that shit's hard.
And
dude,
that riff too. I wrote that part down too. I was like, which one?
It's so very chunky. It's such a chunky fucking riff. But I guess we'll go into it more. But the keyboard, we'll talk about the keyboard more on. But
yes,
I think that's what separates them from a lot of other bands. And there weren't a lot of bands doing this right now. There were definitely no Djent bands doing this necessarily. You know, obviously Meshuggah didn't have fucking keys, you know. So
no, and if they did, it was like one-offs or like samples. But it wasn't. It definitely wasn't like that. Yeah, exactly. Like this.
But yeah, that's all I want to say about
it. Yeah, dude, this song's fucking awesome.
Rules, man.
That part does rule. Yeah, I wrote it down as a sample too. But yeah, going to Drifts. The blasting.
Dude, that blast beat part.
Ooh, just keep it going.
Man.
That first solo like melody thing just smacks. The part that I don't like about the song is that part where he just talks everything I know.
Oh.
Come on, dude. Why do people do this? They do it twice on this album. I'll bring up the other time they do it. I'm just like,
but
it doesn't fit. Like, it doesn't make any sense.
I don't get it.
Who goes into the studio during these parts? Like, I have to talk to a producer in metal and be like, what is up with these random trends in like the mid-2000s where people just talk?
Just talk
like,
over
randomly.
It.
Some people do it. Some people pull it off. Some people
no,
like,
no, sure.
This is the voice of the voiceless. You're just like, that fucking rules.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. We talked about that, but you have to be so like, like, that one at least is like a speech. It's a spoken word before the song starts, you know, for Number Days. It makes sense. This one, it's just a random start to like a bar.
It's in place.
Everything I know.
But the solo is fantastic.
Dude, this guy can play. Trent can play, bro. He's very good.
Oh, man.
That's the whole thing, too, is I remember seeing after the burial, and I think it was Berzerker is the song that I remember seeing them play. And I was just like, man, why don't they accentuate those guitar harmonies more? Because those guys can fucking rip. And I remember they were playing really cool, those like really bright neon guitars, like neon string.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I was watching, and they're just going nuts.
And they have the black lights, too, it's like orange really and
cool.
green.
And I was trying so hard not to headbang, because I was like, I hate these guys. Posers. Well, I can't even fucking do 1/4 of the guitar work that dude can do, you know what I mean? Like, he's incredible, but...
Yeah, that's pretty insane.
Yeah, what's it called? The solo, like you said, during the breakdown is really sick, especially when they go back to the blast and the tremolo picking. I love it. And then, dude, every time now I put like another breakdown, I just got to give them the DJ Khaled. Another one.
Dude, the thing I love about Drifts is because they have a breakdown within a fucking breakdown. Like breakdownception, you know?
I wrote it down, dude. It's at 2:44.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Do we have to listen to that?
I want to save mine for the best, dude.
Okay.
For the best fucking breakdown of all
DJ
breakdowns.
The best.
But yeah, that's the thing about Drifts is that's the thing that sticks out whenever I think of Drifts. I think about they have a breakdown and at the end they fucking break it down even more. Once you think it's already broken down, they're like, fucking break it down again.
Break it more.
more. Like, oh, man.
Crush that bitch.
And it's so Meshuggah.
Some djent band who just breaks down all the time. Every time they break down or hit that drop, just need like a flash image of DJ Khaled. Just like, another one. Oh, you thought we were done? Another. That would be a great way for After the Burial to end their set. They just, lights go down, another one. And there's,
I think of Saving Silverman. Oh, she thinks it's over? No, ha! You thought it was over? No, but yeah, fucking Drift.
It's Drift's fucking rules.
Let's get down to it. Which one are you guys going with?
Oh, man. I'm going Empire's Erase.
I'm going Empire's Erase, too.
Oh, you motherfuckers.
Oh, really?
I did go with Drift's, but just because that the last fucking minute is just a whole fucking break. Dude. And it rules. It rules.
These two songs are close.
So
but
for,
no,
for
that's
this,
cool.
And I was
going to
say with Drift's, I didn't even mention there was a guest vocalist, Alec Haza. And for that one, I literally couldn't tell when he came in. Like, I didn't know. Like,
you can tell the asshole. Difference on.
Maybe he's the guy who came in and was just like, everything I know. All right, guys. Maybe that's the guy.
Pay me my money.
Pay me my money.
Sick ass spoken word. He dropped some knowledge upon us.
Oh, he told us everything he knew.
Okay, cool. No, I respect the decision. I respect it.
But why do you think Drift's is better? Just more complete song? Or?
Yeah, I just think it goes harder, to be honest. But Empire is Erased. It has more of a dynamic. So I respect the decision. I just but whenever it comes down to a lot of these choices that I make, it's like, which one would I rather listen to? And if I put them next to each other, I would rather do Drift's, but. No, I respect Empire's Erase. There's a lot of contrast, and especially within the short amount of time, of both of these albums are short as shit. But
they really
I think Spotify said that fucking, what's it called? The new Reign is like fucking.
It's like 26 minutes.
I think Rareform's 26. I think the new Reign's like 21, 22.
Jesus,
like,
that's crazy.
Shorter than fucking Reign and Blood, and Reign and Blood is short as fuck. So impressive. Impressive.
Don't you ever put those two albums in. I'm triggered.
I'm mad.
Get out of here. Empire Race gets the pentagram of truth. Yeah. All right, on to track number three, fellas. Open Arms to Damnation versus Cursing.
I don't know, dude. Akhenaton.
I'm going to say Cursing.
He was the pharaoh who was the father of King Tut.
Nice to know.
I can't say his name.
History lesson.
Just letting you know, he's King Tut's father.
I gotta say, when I first heard Cursing, I fucking hated this song. But really? I went over and over because I listened to these because we do this pod, right? I listened a couple of times, like, huh. This is getting better.
This is fucking getting better.
Because
this is the only like mid-tempo
like
riffing where it builds up and they keep that pace going.
Dude, it's fucking good.
I really like it.
That intro is just so fucking epic. It's slow.
Keep it building, and then you just keep it grooving on that.
And then it gets really fast and it slows down to that mid-tempo again. It's very different from the
way Drift's and Berzerker start because they're obviously both very fast. Yes. Whereas this one, I've seen them open with it and it's just like,
That's what I was gonna say.
That sounds like a good opener.
Yeah, for sure. But yeah, it actually took me a while to appreciate the song as well. So I can't blame you for it taking a few.
But that
lessons.
That part where it gets faster, that 2 minute, do that circle pit.
Oh,
heaven.
Dude,
like,
I
don't
can't
get in my
that.
Way. Even the 3:10 breakdown party, but that last rip, that last
3:13 pit breaker, baby.
But dude, it is like it is such a Meshuggah. Like it is literally
care.
A Meshuggah.
That's fucking cool.
I don't know which one, but it's one of them. And I just sat there at the end. I'm like, God damn it! I don't know which one this. Oh, I think it was. Future Breed Machine. Like it's the exact same.
Dude,
I'll find
rips.
It. I didn't look it up, but I'll look it up one day. And I was like, all right, that's the only one that threw me off. But that song is awesome. But Open Arms to Damnation.
Really
good
quick,
riffs, drums.
Just, really quick about cursing. That one part where it slows down and he's like, the earth is now set upon from the torment I have set upon it. All shall bow, serve, and praise thy name. Like, dude, right before it goes into that fucking breakdown. Bro, that is some straight up Emotep from the Mummy shit.
I know, right?
Shout out to my boy fucking Brendan Fraser. I still love you.
Fraser is the cringiest human being.
Man, fuck you.
I think ever.
Hollywood did him dirty.
Okay, everyone shits on Nick Cage. I think Brendan Fraser is like 10 times
no
worse.
No way, fuck dude. You're crazy, you, bro. Man.
Cage, Brendan Fraser. I hate the, oh what's the, what's the one where he's a caveman? What's that movie called?
Encino Man?
Dude. Oh, Encino Man's a fucking legendary
classic. He's so greasy, buddy. You're like, fuck you. Okay, okay. This is going to get too heated. Okay, but let's move on. Let's move on. All right,
let's go, let's go.
No, no, to what was the
cursing,
other song?
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, going on. Open Arms.
Let's get off that subject.
Oh, my God.
Open Arms of Damnation. Dude, so this one, to me, had a good intro, but the pacing of the chorus was weird. Like, it didn't, I don't know, for some reason it wasn't, like, clicking.
Yeah, it was
like,
a little
it just,
off.
It's a lot of, like, random stuff just thrown at you.
That's what I said. It was pretty mixed. It's like a bunch okay, of stuff.
I had to write this, guys. The keys what? Over, like, the 50-second breakdown just do not fit, like, in my personal opinion. Like, there's some times where the keys fit. This is not one of them. Like, I'm not a big fan.
Am
I alone? This is a hot take?
I think it's a hot take because that was it's definitely one of the songs that makes me realize, like, even though obviously we've just within this time frame, we've noticed that After the Burial does have better guitar work. They just have more talented, like Justin and Trent work so good together. Mm-hmm. The thing that sets Born of Osiris apart is their keyboard. And I think maybe they tried a little too hard on this part, but
because
I just think it was fucking, it's like there weren't a lot of bands doing that, especially metalcore. I mean, the only one I could think of is like Bleeding Through. It's okay. One of the only bands that were actually doing the keyboard parts, and like a keyboard breakdown hadn't even existed prior to this. So,
About Between the Buried and Me? A little bit,
I guess. Oh, man, it's
but
hard.
not like this. Like, yeah,
they're like way more progressive.
Yeah,
than either
yeah they're
like,
not really like a
I guess,
they're not
I guess progressive deathcore like
I don't
Buried.
Know what they are. They're progressive metal.
They're pioneers. They're pioneers.
They're deathcore. I think they're like those. Their riffs are like more. I don't know.
I don't know. Fuck. I don't think so.
Damn subgenres.
If I had to, I would call them progressive deathcore. Like if I had to, but. That sounds pretentious.
It all does, dude.
Like, yeah. That would scare a fledgling metal fan right off and be like, I'll never understand. I'll never get any of this. It was all just metal to me. And like, this isn't metal, okay? This is progressive deathcore. Like, oh my God.
Don't you ever fucking tell me it's progressive metalcore, because it's not, okay? But no, dude, it was that, I don't know, man. That it was that part, and then the key, like there's an actual key solo. And like when it changes keys, right? And when it does, like I just didn't think it fit the music. Like it was too positive sounding, right?
Respect
it's
that.
Kind of like Children of Bodom. The dude just hijacked this for a second. I was like, let me throw this in there. I don't know why it's different, but whatever.
I need to get laid too. let me do it while pointing at a girl in the audience and be like,
my
you
one-handed bitch. After
I think of Opeth playing fucking what's the really popular Windowpane.
Oh,
I remember Mikael Akerfeld being like, now the song that'll get us chicks after the show backstage, you know, and he just knows the self-awareness 10 out of 10. So hey,
dude,
you know, keyboardist needs to get laid too, okay?
Yeah, that's true.
It's usually the guitarist and the vocalist that get laid. Hey, keyboardists need love too, you know what I mean? So that's what I justify that part.
That's hilarious.
Keyboardists need love. I think Jordan Rudess needs love from Dream Theater.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, dude, that guy's a freak nature.
Yeah.
Oh, at least you like him. You're a Dream Theater hater.
I'm not the biggest Dream Theater fan.
Whatever. Anyway, let's get down to it. Which one are you guys going with? I'm going with Cursing.
Yeah, same here, man.
I just really love that. I thought it was different. It was a grower, but it hit me better.
I went with Open Arms just because the ending is just so like live. Like everyone's just like, yo, you got a one-way ticket to hell. Like, dude, it just goes so hard. But
Maybe one day we should listen together beforehand and get pumped up.
But that's the thing. It was so close.
Yeah,
like,
this one
it was close. Remember at the last one, I chose like... I'd chosen Drifts over Empire's Erase, so I was like, oh, I can't pick three After the Burial songs in a row.
Yes, you can.
So yeah. But I just had to. I made the choice to Open Arms, but I love Cursing. Yeah, so
they're both badass.
Yeah,
dude.
I cannot.
So Cursing
gets
the Pentagram of Truth. Let's go to track number 4. Abstract Art versus.
Sorry, this, to me this was a blowout, dude.
I thought Fuck. It was a little bit too.
Dude, which one do you want to start off with? It don't matter to me.
Well, which one did you think was the blow? What did you think was the clear winner?
Or do you want to hear what I thought? Let's go to Rareform 205. Put it on for me. I just want to hear it already. Let's fuck it up. Let's fuck this shit up.
Crack that beer open. Crack that beer open.
I wish it was a beer. It's a truly. Oh, I'm trying to be a better person.
Oh, this guy.
Speaking of which, truly, you should sponsor us. It's heaven in a con.
Oh my
shit.
God.
All right, so Rareform, what was the time?
205. Dude, just imagine the singer telling you, open this shit up. Everybody move. Just wait for it.
This is so fucking kill switch to me. This part is so kill switch.
Everybody. Everybody.
Get up. Everyone get up. Quit sitting down. It's time to get up. God damn! Dude, that is so raw.
I don't even need to hear the other song.
Oh, and then the triplets on the drum. Oh, get that going. Yeah, man.
It's my favorite song off these two albums.
Yeah, I wrote that part down too. But I put it 155. It's like that whole build up.
Oh, the whole thing.
The whole build up to it is
great.
Play
the whole fucking
song.
Because,
dude, to me, they do a lot of the Djent breakdowns. But that might be the best breakdown on the fucking album. And it's not even close.
It's my favorite.
It's not that complicated. It's not anything like crazy. It's just, it hits right.
No, dude, I just imagine the live aspect of it. Dude, I would lose my fucking mind. Have you seen this live? Have they played this?
Man, honestly,
I don't think. I was trying to look it up, and I couldn't find it.
They probably haven't played it live in a decade, too.
Damn, that sucks. They should do an anniversary at the 15-year.
That'd be cool. Honestly, once I see them nowadays, I really don't see them playing more than Berzerker and Aspiration live. I don't think they played, but at one point, hopefully, maybe they'll do a 20-year anniversary when they're old as fuck playing this, you know.
I just want to hear that shit.
But yeah, no, that like I said, I just think it sounds so kill switchy. Like the bass quality.
Yeah, it really
like,
is.
Oh,
it really is.
But yeah,
is.
No, it was a really good shit. And yeah, I like the main riff is super catchy, and I think the lyrics are really retrospective on them. And once again, that's Trent. That's my boy Trent writing the lyrics, and it's just a really good song overall. Rareform, that is a good title track for sure. Like,
dude,
a really great track.
It's a great track. I love it.
Yeah, but it's the only problem about this track is a spoken word the second time.
Oh, dude,
I must
go.
It's
not that big of a deal.
It's not that big of a deal, but it just, it irks me. You know my pet peeves with that shit. But no, the Rareform is a great title track. It's a smacker. I'm surprised they don't play it because, like you said, dude, I can't.
Why,
that would
dude?
Be such a great buildup.
Especially live.
Yeah, but anyway, let's talk about abstract art.
Dude, that is a weird intro, but dude, it does get heavier, and it's. I think it's a good song too. I really do.
Oh man,
yeah, the keyboard middle before the breakdown. Come on, that's pretty cool.
I really do. Honestly, the key. Oh, are we good? Okay. The keyboard breakdown of Abstract Art is really one of the coolest fucking breakdowns.
It is.
Like,
it really is.
That
I
is
disagree
really
with both of you.
Oh, sorry, you're a keyboard hater.
I'm not a keyboard hater. I just like. For me, there's just something that I just, it didn't fit for me, man. I don't know what it was.
It just, it's just so, like, obviously, Winds of Play came along and hijacked the Asian metalcore thing, but this shit is just so, like, it just sounds like an ancient Asian, like, fucking.
Yeah,
like,
see, I just thought it came out of nowhere. Like, I don't know. It's a part. I'm going to put the part on so people know what we're talking about because I highlighted it.
It's at 150.
Yeah. Because I highlighted it, and I would love to know what people think. Maybe I'm alone, but
let's tell Will how wrong he is.
Dude, he's definitely wrong.
Oh, I hate you guys. I hate
he's
you.
He's like, I'm editing this shit out.
You're never coming back on the pod.
You're done. That's like Dream Theater. Come on, you love that shit. Why are you hating on that?
I don't know, man. It's just. The syncopation with his scream was pretty cool.
That's all you got to say.
I don't know what else to say. If you don't have anything nice to say, don't say it at all. That is definitely not the rule in this podcast.
That's the way I would run the podcast, unfortunately. Just be positive, you guys.
Every song is great and unique.
It really pushed the boundaries.
Hence the reason I was like, let's not talk about that band that made that mistake earlier, because they probably listened to that. We don't want to be mean.
Oh, God.
But
abstract art, I just think it's one of, obviously, I think it just highlights one of the things that sets Born of Osiris apart from other bands is just those fucking, how many bands have that fucking sick-ass keyboard breakdowns? Like, it would be sick if more bands had them, but I feel like they were some of the originators, and some people, hey, maybe y'all could point me in direction of more bands that had more, but the only one band that I could think of is, like, Bleeding Through on Sister Charlatan by Bleeding Through off Declaration. Shit smacks way too hard, but otherwise I just don't see too many. Like,
yeah, you're right. I can't like, on the top of my head, especially with like this subgenre of metal, like I'd have to go back and dive and find one. But for me, like I said, I don't love it. Like this one, I didn't think this one was as bad, because at least it's in a minor key. Like, it fit a little bit better. It's just the tone of that synth is just very interesting. I was like, okay, all right. But I gotta go rare for him. I gotta go rare for him.
Oh yeah,
I gotta throw that up there.
That's... You motherfucker!
Oh no way!
I chose abstract.
What?
Art. I went by a song I'd rather listen to. I'd rather.
Damn, Stephen's got the EDM. Bug.
No, it's all. But that's the thing is, I went complete opposite from you guys, because like, all right, we got to give fucking Buenos Aires or like fucking a chance here. but yeah, no, I respect the decision, because they're all. Like,
they're all I thought they're still close. Like, it wasn't like a blowout. It's just that one riff.
This
one
was a blowout.
That one riff, like that breakdown, just ended worlds. Like, I was like, all right, how can you go against this? And then abstract art, besides that part, like, I'd say it's controversial, quote unquote, but it's better. Like, I don't hate it. It's just like, it's not my cup of tea, I guess I put it.
No,
but,
understandable. So that's why I'm like, all right, like, I'll chose the other one. Like,
but I'm glad they did. You know, the respect goes as a musician trying something different, which I'll always respect. Yeah. Like you said, no one was doing it. Throw it in there. Do something. Be different is always good. So.
And that's like why I chose these two albums, is because it's just so difficult to. All of it was difficult, you know, for me, like which one was the better one. And everything was like kind of, there weren't really any blowouts, maybe except like Berzerker is just too nasty of a track. Like that's, I guess we all agree. Yeah. All three. Yeah. That one is just, it's just 6-7 minutes of fucking straight smashing. But otherwise, a lot of these were really close.
Real close.
For me.
I agree with that. But Rareform gets the pentagram of truth. So let us get to the half point. Let's talk about these album covers.
Oh, man.
Okay, so the Eternal Reign one is really cool.
That one's better, yeah.
If we have to compare the remasters, the Eternal Reign's probably the best album cover.
Oh, for sure.
Rareform's all right, but the original, like, the New Reign's just, Reign,
that
wow.
Butt, dude.
That's interesting.
It's like night and day.
I'm glad
the
they remastered the album cover.
As well,
A good choice from Born of Osiris. But,
sorry, dude. It's really night and day.
For sure.
Okay, but... Dude, you got to tell me, because like, you told me about this guitarist. There's some crazy, like he died in crazy circumstances.
Oh my goodness.
I didn't look it up.
Oh,
I should have.
Yeah.
And it's Justin. I'm so rest in peace, Justin. Okay. Power.
Justin Lowe. I initially went into it thinking that it was going to be a big, like almost like we're going to add some true crime shit into this fucking podcast. But like, I was like, we're going to fucking solve the mystery. But there's no mystery. In 2015, when he left the band, he did so via Facebook post, and he left a really, on his personal Facebook, he left a really, really disturbing message on his, and it's long. You could still read it. You could read it at if you do Loudwire After the Burial. The title is After the Burial, guitarist Justin Lowe cites conspiracy for leaving band. Honestly, dude, like I'll read the first paragraph. He says, my decision to leave After the Burial, where do I begin? I've been set up, guys, by something more powerful than law enforcement, and it's bad. Shit is about to hit the fan on an epic scale, and the only thing I could do now is tell you as much of my side as I can. I've been removed as admin from the After the Burial band account, so I'm hoping this letter reaches as many people as possible. I'm going to start from the most recent and go backwards. As some of you may know, After the Burial currently records at the Machine Shop in Belleville, New Jersey. Immediately upon entering, something wasn't right. I thought, maybe it's just me, or maybe I'm just being paranoid for no reason. Then things got interesting. From the beginning, there was a kit set up to connect MacBook hard drives and duplicate them at the studio. Seems unusual, right? So he goes on to talk about how, first off, somebody sabotaged his MacBook and poured coffee directly into the master board. He goes on to say, my body is telling me to get the fuck out now. And, like, he just thinks that everyone went on. He goes on to say some really, really crazy things. He talks about how he was basically molested as a child. And he talks about a lot of things, including one of his best friends committed suicide, and that he was saying that he went over to his friend's and the friend was cutting some jerky and accidentally cut his hand while cutting it, and some of the blood got on his shorts. And they're saying, basically, they're trying to pin me for the murder of my friend that committed suicide, but he's not really dead.
How long after that post did he die?
Either way, the post was really, and you could, it had been deleted. It was taken down because it was obviously the ravings of someone that was really not mentally well. If you read a different, that was the Loudwire article. The Billboard article states their retort, because After the Burial had to say something, and it said After the Burial said that basically mental illness is a very serious matter and we're treating it as such. And they talked about how they noticed that he had been a little weird and he left recording a little early. Mm-hmm. But I guess, long story short, man, he was going through some shit and they didn't really notice till it was a little too late. I think maybe... he went missing after that. He went missing and they found him and he was back with his family. And that's when After the Burial released the statement. And they're saying, I know y'all have been asking about this, but, you know, he's safe with his family. They're saying, you know, if you notice something weird about a friend, you should report it. And same thing. So got a little branching off, like, mental health is not something that we talk about a lot, especially in metal. It's like, it's a man. You got to be a man and man up, cowboy up. But if you notice somebody acting weird, somebody that you're close to, that you work with, that you make music with, that you record a podcast with, if you see somebody acting funky, don't hesitate to reach out to them or like ask them, say, I'm concerned about your health, because this is something that happened. Like, they were acting weird and they just kind of brushed it off. He ultimately fled. And I think about maybe a month or two later, he went missing. And they found out, like, the local paper had released saying that a man was found off a bridge, you know, clearly that it was a fall. And it was something they read that and they immediately knew it was Justin Lowe. They immediately, like, the mad members, band members knew that it was Justin Lowe that had fallen and died. Jeez. So sure enough, it was released and it was him. And it was just something that he probably should have been institutionalized or something like that, but it was just something that no one saw, because obviously mental health, it doesn't matter whether you're a rock star or whether you work as a greeter. It doesn't matter.
And sometimes it's hard to see, too. Yeah. And then it's like, do I butt in? Like, what's going on? Yeah, right. Could be having personal shit.
Yeah,
but yeah, I agree. And it wasn't, like, drug-induced? They didn't find any drugs in the system?
Not really, man. But
it sounds like a rambling of, like, a meth.
Sounds like reading that. If you read that since-deleted post, it reads really where no rational human being is like, yeah, you're being set up for the murder of this person that committed, like, it's just rambling. And so I'm sure that concerned a lot of people. And sometimes you're like, oh, I hope he gets help. You should step in and do something. You should step in and do something. So that was something that you think it was something like, oh, because it was of an apparent fall. you know, and it was ultimately ruled a suicide. But, mm-hmm. you know, I guess if any conspiracy theorists thought that it was something more. But after going back and reading the post, it's like there was that none of that was really all that coherent. And there, none of it. He said he had started to connect the dots from years. This goes back deep, you know, and it just wasn't.
Dude, that's damn.
Yeah, it was. But yeah,
no idea.
Yeah, no. Rest in peace, Justin Lowe, for sure. They haven't replaced him ever since. Trent still plays on his own and plays backing tracks for Justin's guitar.
Yeah, because Justin did the drums too, and I was like, that guy's a fucking good musician, man.
Yeah.
Sometimes like the really creative people tend to be more susceptible to things like that. You know what
so
I mean?
Your mind's racing. Yeah.
Yeah, mine's racing all the time. You know, you get worked up in your own thoughts, and you know, I don't know, man. There's so many things. Like you said, mental illness. I mean, it just fucking creeps up, and you know, it's like you said, if you see your fucking friends acting up, man, you just gotta fucking call it out. And I'm sure the dudes in the band tried. Who knows? But that's fucking, that sucks. Yeah, it's a horrible situation.
Because if I saw you post some shit like that, like, Bill, hey, man, let's hang out. Because
right, dude?
What are you talking about?
Right?
Like, that's so true. Damn, man, that's fucking crazy. I had no idea. I just remember reading that he, like, died.
Yeah,
and then he
too.
Disappeared. But I was just like, damn, that's crazy. Because wasn't it around close to the same time Ollie from All That Remains died? Like, it wasn't too far away, I feel like.
I don't think it was either, yeah.
And I just remember, like, both being weird and like, dude, what the fuck happened?
That one's a different conspiracy.
That one's a whole, on an All That Remains conspiracy. We got to go down that one. That one's crazy. But, yeah, dude, that sucks, man. Rest in power, because that dude's a legend.
Damn.
You know, great drumming, great rhythm guitar, but damn it. Now I'm somber note. Let's continue.
Now that I got to
try to kill the vibe.
Kill the vibe killer. No, I was just playing, bro. It's life.
We get some aspiration on this next one.
Yeah. Oh, shut the fuck up. All right, guys. Track number five.
Good transition.
Track number five. Aspiration versus the new Reign. Who wants to start this one up? Dude, this one's pretty fucking hard.
Yeah.
This one was really hard. I was going back and forth with this one.
I know seeing After the Barrel live Aspiration, they do dedicate that shit to Justin.
Oh, really? That's cool.
It's so uplifting. Lifting.
Yeah,
the intro's so uplifting.
It's such that intro is beautiful, you know, and it's well written lyrics that were obviously written when he was alive. So it's a good tribute to him every time they play that live.
Yeah.
So yeah,
good intro, and then it gets Chuggalicious, dude. Ooh, get that Djent going, dude.
And then there's like the intro for some reason reminded me of ABR. I don't know why.
It's
like,
a little
Mariana's Trench esque. I don't know why I thought that, but the fucking the first riff that had a lot of air like around it, like it was breathable, right? So I thought that was really refreshing, especially after all the breakdowns. But then they go right back to the formula, dude.
Come on. Yeah.
Gotta bring the formula
they
back.
They fade out with it, too, at the end. They just keep
djenting to the end. Djenting to death, Meshuggah. But all I think is Meshuggah at that part, especially the end. But the solo's really fucking good.
Oh,
it's
a
banger of a song.
Dude, but New Reign, it's complex. It's actually a really complex
song. Again, with the amazingly ridiculous intro to just start the shit off.
Oh, get that cowbell going.
Just destroys. I think the keys work really well here. Like, I like the ambiance of the keys, right? Like, I thought they sent the move really well. And that 1 minute breakdown is just a smacker, dude.
Oh, yeah, the drums and the guitar work well together in this one really
and
well.
But the second time they bring in the keys, that's the time I'm like, I think probably could have left it out, but either way, I thought it was a better use when they use it as more of like a background like vibe, right? Versus like an upfront thing. But obviously, that's just personal taste.
Yeah, no, it gives it a really futuristic vibe.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
It just sounds like the future. Like we're listening to the fucking future right now.
But this one was like extremely hard. So I don't know who wants to take a pick on this. And we're already an hour in, so we got to go a little bit faster.
I'm personally going to go with a New Reign. I like that song a lot.
Stefan, I'm going to let you go this time.
Man, I did go with Aspiration on that one.
Wow.
I did go with Aspiration. It's just a good fucking song. Like,
funny.
The outgoing in breakdown is just good. And like,
yeah.
What are you going with?
This one was extremely hard, dude. But I think I'm going to go Aspiration.
Aspiration?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It could have been
I just think afterwards, like going back and forth, I thought Aspiration was just the catchier song.
It is. There's just it's hard to explain. It's simplistic. It really it really doesn't show off the chops that some of the other songs go. But there's just something really, really catchy.
Yeah,
even at the end, like the breakdown, the and it just it's the same shit towards the way out. And but it's just I don't know. There's something when it comes down to it, I'd rather listen to Aspiration than the New Reign, even though the New Reign fucking rips. So
yeah, I agree. All right, so Aspiration gets the Pentagram of Truth. So let's go to track number six, fellas. Brace Legs versus the Fractal Effect. I thought this one was easier.
What easier? Brace Legs is hard, man. Oh, that that song goes fucking all straight.
Right. We're going to Brace Legs.
I know, it's very quick.
I'm sorry,
but...
Brace Legs, the keys once again, dude.
Dude, you're just fucking hating on this.
The keys, bro. Yeah, I think honestly it's one of my favorite songs on the album. Brace Legs, really? Yeah,
yeah,
I think it's
I'm missing something.
I think it's one of the heaviest, and I think it has the most death influence, like the most death metal influence of all of the tracks. I mean, I think the melodic keys, I think they contrast really well with the. Just the heavy fucking riffage, and I think the part, if we could just listen to 150 on fucking on Brace Legs, that's the last time I'll fucking that's the last time I'll say we need to listen to shit.
What 150?
150. It's like it gets progressively heavier. Like every line just gets heavier.
He takes an octave lower.
Oh, there we go. Oh, yeah. That's the ticket.
Get up.
No, dude, both are really fun, though. The Fractal Effect has some cool stuff. Yeah. Dude, they have that one part where you just want to groove and dance. Oh,
I was about to say, I'm going to put on my part for Fractal Effect.
Oh, dude, yeah.
The 2 minute part?
The 2 minute.
Yeah.
Oh, it's dude, a battle of dance, stuff baby. On. It's a battle.
I could dig it.
Yeah, this shit got me, too, from the Fractal Effect.
Panty, the guitar.
Sounds like Revocation.
There we go.
Woo!
Exactly. Woo! Get the pig going, baby. Oh, I'm creeping like a hungry cat again, dude. Watch out! Oh, yeah. I love that. But what? Once again, that's where, like, After the Burial has more of, like, that In Flames, more, like, mellow death vibe. And of course, like I said, I'm just such a sucker for that type of riffing.
Yeah, and then when it goes into that, once again, one of their weird ass fucking breakdowns, it almost sounds like Korn. It sounds like Djent Korn.
It does a little bit.
I just don't think, I don't see a lot of bands that have, like, I don't know, because it takes a certain, like, courage to be like, fuck it, we're going to do something real weird. So just like,
It's just unique. It's awesome.
For real, for
dude,
real.
Dude, these two, for real, this was the hardest one for me. Like, I put a question mark. I couldn't decide. Like, this is the one I couldn't
And
do.
I don't think I mentioned some of the other songs, but when you listen to Rareform, there's a lot of riffs where they pan the guitars, like, in the breakdowns.
Yeah.
This one uses it because the... There's like a 109 breakdown that's okay. It's not like my favorite breakdown in the world, but I loved when they pan the guitars like... I love that shit because you got really a good pair of headphones on. You're like, okay, all right. You know what I mean? I like that shit. But anyway, which one are you guys going with?
Guys pick. Man, I gotta go.
I'm going to go Fractal Effect. Oh, I'm sorry, dude. I really like it.
Dude, Fractal Effect is great, but dude, Brace Legs is just...
heaviness, right?
Yeah, exactly. That part, like, I remember recording it live and just like, because it just gets progressively heavier to where it's like, oh, like it just has the most, it's just the heaviest track on the thing for me. So even though fucking the Fractal Effect is fucking sick because of the Korn breakdown, really, like Brace Legs is just is just the jam.
Yeah, this one's really it for the taste-wise, because, like, I like that part that you brought up, and especially I can see your vibe, but you know me, dude, and whatever the part I brought up, it's like, I love
that's more of your taste.
I
want to
get in the pit. I want to creep over the water. I'm dancing.
Yeah, those drums, they're sick. Man. They're nasty. But
I just want a mosh, though. Fuck, this is hard.
This is a hard one, dude. This one was super close.
Damn, this is...
Is this the closest one on the album?
To me, this was. I had a fucking hard time. I love both. I really do. The dancing part, the moshing part, all of it's good. If I had to choose, dude, this is really close. I'm gonna go brace legs.
Oh,
in your face!
No, it is a hard one. Trust me.
No, Stefan's right, dude. It gets heavier and heavier,
that part is just like it's just like a 3-layer fucking metal cake. You know, you're like, this first metal's good. Oh, the second. Oh, you know, like
oh, is this Napoleon ice cream?
It's kind of like that Vince McMahon meme where you're just like, oh.
I've seen that shit. Yeah.
It's just like, yeah. By the time they get the really death fucking like the squeal part, just like, oh yes,
dude. You know what a segment nasty. We should. Speaking of Vinnie Mac, like you know what a great segment idea. People who I would not want to meet in the pit, and Vinnie Mac. I would never want to see Vince McMahon doing that gorilla walk in the pit.
That's a ripped ass old man right
oh
there.
My
just voided it up, dude.
Like
just
way
straight
way
up
more. Yeah.
Injection. Oh,
but he's part of the 3-comma club, so I will respect
him. Yeah, whenever like the world ends, like all that will be left are the cockroaches and Vince McMahon.
If he dies, I don't buy it. Like, that guy's never going to die.
Like, he's like Elvis or Tupac. He's just living out in a Caribbean island somewhere. Yeah. He just went home.
All right, guys, track number 7, Bow Down versus Ometh.
This is another close one.
This one's what do you think of the Bow Down intro? Like the isolated vocals?
Dude, I cannot think of too many songs that just gets you, you know. It's just a huge fucking breakdown, that entire fucking
but
song.
I have to admit, Ometh's just a complete song. It's great.
Yeah, that's the thing with Bow Down. There's at this part of the album, I love squealies. Well, this is the part of the album where it's like the law of diminishing returns for both. Just like the Djent breakdowns and the squealies. I was like, all right, this is really
chill
all right.
Out a
it's
bit,
like,
chill out.
Can we do something a little bit different? But I still enjoy it. But you know what I mean? Like it doesn't give you that same oomph anymore. Especially after like 5-6 listens.
Sure. It's just mindless fucking. It's good. Like something takes over for that. But I understand if we want to move
over.
But
that's the pleasure of these albums being short. It didn't bother me. That was fucking fine. Yeah.
But
I
will give
time.
This one Bow Down. The keys during the solo, I thought they were great. Like I thought they were really good.
The one time.
Yo, don't say a one time. I gave some credit, JJ. Fuck you, okay? One time. I'll give you a one time.
Oh, my God.
But anyway, yeah, the fucking...
One time your ass.
I'm a one time.
One time.
But anyway, I thought the keys were really good in that Jesus Christ, dude, the 105 riff is just triplet city. Yeah. Like, if you want triplets, if you like triplets, which everyone likes triplets, just put the song on. It's just triplets, triplets, triplets. But
I circled it up.
Ometh, so I agree. The song as a whole is just a little bit more well-rounded.
And that riff at 303, holy shit. That's so much fun.
It's weird because it's almost like it's so gallopy. It almost sounds like a power metal song.
Yeah, dude, I was about to say, because there's a part where they switch to like a major key and it does give off more of like a power metal-esque vibe.
Dude, that's
122. It's like a riff and a solo.
Yeah. It's just the happiest that you'll ever hear in like a deathcore, like a metalcore song. Like it's so like, that's the happiest solo you'll ever see. It's almost like Trans-Siberian Orchestra-esque. It's like, it's really, really happy, which is fucking weird. You know? Listen to be like, I'm going to listen to some happy music, you know? Like, this isn't what you put on. Like,
oh my gosh.
I want to feel better about my life. But,
I never want to feel that way. I want to listen to Carcass.
Yeah, no.
I want to be angry.
Me, I myself, I am darkness and despair. I am the night. You know?
Oh my God.
But yeah.
Get the PMA shit out of here. Minor Threat. Yeah. JJ, what do you think? What are you going with? What are we doing here?
I'm going with Ometh, dude.
I thought this was a little bit easier for me personally. Yeah. Stefan, what do you think?
I gotta go with Ometh too. It's just a good fucking jam.
Yeah, Ometh. I thought that was a little bit easier. I like Bow Down, but it wasn't like it was okay.
Yeah, and then the guitar work is just too fucking good on Ometh.
And then this is track number 8, the last track, the Takeover versus a Vicious Reforming of Features. No, dude, honestly, this is one of my easiest choices.
I really
thought a Vicious Reforming is too long. Like, I don't think it's that good of a song. That's my least favorite song in the album.
Damn, dude.
I don't understand why it's five and a half. Like, it's like 6 minutes of the same shit. I'm sorry. I like it, but it's just like, it's not as good as Berzerk, which is, I think, close to 6 minutes and not is much better. I just thought this one, like, especially after listening over and over, I thought it was,
A little too repetitive.
The most lackluster track on the album. Like, it wasn't.
It just has a little bit too much fat for you.
Yeah, then, I thought a lot of, like, if it was a 3 minute song, I think it would have been much better. But it,
yeah.
Like, the intro, the panning, once again, I love. Like, I love that shit, but it just didn't catch me. I thought it's just, you know, there's some fat.
The lyrics are really out there, and I don't know what the fuck they're talking about on this track. Riff, I'm like, oh, God. I don't know what's going on with these lyrics, but dude, that end, that breakdown at 3:15,
just the fade out, really?
That is heavy, filthy, man.
Do you want to put it on? Do you want me to put it on?
Dude, one last time.
Let's put it at 3:15 because that's the way you end a fucking album.
Let me listen to it again.
That's the way you end an album.
Strong. 3:15, right?
Yeah, it's okay. It's long, but the shredding tissue part.
The one they started with, like, speaking back to my point, like, I just don't think that one was anything, like,
spectacular.
That, like, it's nothing, like, that's, like, kill, like, amazing for me. Like, that Berzerker that we put on Earth, like, that one to me is, like, super original. This one was, like, okay, let's fucking rip off Meshuggah again
it's definitely the 20th time. It's definitely a build up for sure. Because, yeah, the beginning, honestly, like, listening to this, I was like, ah, shit, I don't know about this jam. I haven't really listened to it too much. But that ending part just goes so fucking hard, dude. Like, it just, God, that part and just the vocal cadence for that. And, it's just a strong ending to that album. And Rareform is just, I appreciate us doing this fucking, that, like, giving me a reason to re-listen to this album because I forgot how fucking great it is. It's short and sweet, man. Both these albums are short and sweet,
which I love. They don't overstay their welcome.
Yeah.
Which, you know, even as a Meshuggah fan, I know, like, I ain't listened to 3 Meshuggah albums.
No, there's no fucking way. There is no way.
We all do like an hour and a half, and then me and Meshuggah got to take a little bit of a break. But yeah, they don't overstay their welcome at all.
For sure.
It was just something about it where I was like, it's okay. It's not like I hate it. It was just it was okay. But
on the opposite, I feel the same way about the Takeover.
Really? I thought the Takeover was good.
No, as in, like, they're both like, at the very end, it's like, oh, come on, let's go with it.
Yeah, but the intro, dude, that guitar stops on the intro verse, just the drums are just
ripping. You actually like the piano in?
I don't.
The soft voice?
Okay. I don't.
I'm surprised you.
I don't
like
hate it.
It's okay, but you don't like it.
Yeah, but no, you're good. Get back to the drumming.
It.
Yeah, Cameron.
The
Loach
drumming
this,
is fucking phenomenal. Dude.
Yeah, it is.
Like,
it is.
Fuck.
The double bass work.
Yeah, the double bass work is great. But I just, for me, it was a little bit that 50-second riff was the only one that I put. I was like, this literally sounds like After the Burial. Like, at a point, I was like, am I listening to After the Burial? No, this is Born of Osiris. But no, I thought the Takeover, for me personally, was a better song. I liked it to end the album a little bit better. Because it was still just punchy, like real quick, you know?
Yeah,
Once again, smacking, and then they fade out. They both actually fade out, right?
Yeah, they both fade out.
Yeah.
It got me, like, especially the end. Yeah, the ending, it just makes you feel like you're watching, like, Carl Sagan talk about the cosmos. Like,
right.
You took a trip to the fucking planetarium and, like, damn.
Yeah.
There really is more out there. The truth is out there, bro. No, but.
And not only is it out there, we're going to take it over.
Hell yeah,
oh,
brother.
You know my real beef with the song
what
is?
What is it?
There's
what
only
it?
One Takeover, and it was written by Jay-Z. The Takeover. The break's over. God MC. Me, Jehovah. Tell him, Jay. You can't. I'm calling the lyric police on Board of Osiris. You cannot take the Takeover, dude. There's only one Takeover, and it's the diss to Nas and Mobb Deep. Just saying.
He's just going
just
OG.
Saying.
He's going OG. It's
I'm
hard.
Going OG.
It's hard to argue with that. It's really hard to argue with that.
Which is probably around this, what is it, 2007? I'm pretty sure the Takeover is written like 2005.
Yeah.
It was pretty close. It was very close.
It's a ripoff.
They ripped it off.
They ripped it off.
And that's what I was going to say. This is a complete Jay-Z ripoff, so I can. Hey, he is the God MC, Jehovah. You know how it is.
Jehovah.
But which one are y'all going with?
I actually don't even know what I would take.
I'm going to go with the Takeover. I already kind of.
I think I'm going with Vicious, man.
Man, yeah. I'm sorry, but I got to go with Vicious, man.
I'm getting torn apart.
Hey, y'all fucking tore me apart at the beginning, man. Right, y'all complete, like,
we were teaming up.
Stefan, really? Fuck. Fucking Dudley boy.
Fuck, when you got here, we were talking. We were like, we're going to fucking Stefan.
That 3D on you.
The first three, we just got to fucking do the opposite of what he fucking says, whatever we said.
Exactly. All right. A Vicious reforming of features gets the pentagram of truth.
I don't even know what one.
We're at the end here.
I'm excited.
After the burial, Rareform got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 over the 2 from the new Reign.
The new Reign only got 2?
The new Reign only got 2 pentagrams. So it's a big win for After the Burial. So, Stefan, you're the bigger fan of both these.
Man,
what do you think about this outcome?
Honestly, in my marks, it was 4-4, bro. Like,
really?
It was like... Yeah, it was up for y'all to be the tiebreaker because
mine was 5-3.
Yeah, so it's close. What about you?
It was pretty close.
6-2.
6-2 for after the burial?
No, for after the burial.
Yeah, because I mean, listening to it, honestly, just the guitar work of both Justin and Trent on this are just like, it was, for lack of better words, masterful, man. Like, yeah. it was just really, really well done. So, even like, I understand why, Born of Osiris would be like, dude, the new Reign was sweet, but let's fucking remaster that shit. And it like breathed new life into an album that was still great, but obviously, like, it just goes to show how, like, important production value is, you know, yeah. Especially in this subgenre of music is just really important. So it was honestly a close match for me because these are two albums I listen to, like, a lot because they're both short, sweet. You can get a fucking 30-minute workout into them right quick. Like, they mm-hmm. don't, there's not a lot of fat on either
yeah,
one of them.
Yeah.
If anyone had a bit of fat, it was after the burial that you're there's right. There's probably, they could have cut down a few minutes, but
yeah.
Even then they didn't fuck around with a lot of it, you know. So
yeah, you're very right.
They're just both really, really good albums that that just like fast paced, just get to the fucking point.
Yeah.
Don't fuck around.
I just think after the burial, the reason it got the win is because it's definitely more polished. Their second or third album by then?
It's their second album.
Their second album. They have more growth. They have more depth. They have many more elements to their music.
Yeah.
And they're both the same. Like, technically they're similar in style.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
You're able to add more dimension into After the Burial, which I love. And they were able to add it, and that's why I think it got the win.
I agree, personally. Yeah. And for me, it was close too. But I thought After the Burial had the better album. I thought they were very close. The Born of Osiris one, like we talked about, it was less polished. Probably the second release, the Magna Opus, is probably better. You know, the Discovery. What was it called?
The Discovery.
Yeah, I have to check that one out because there's a lot of songs where you're like, you can see that they have it. You know, they just need to refine a lot of it.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Because I didn't bring this up, but there's a couple songs where I'm like, they just end very abruptly. Like, there's not like great conclusions.
I feel like they didn't know how to end it.
Yeah. Whereas like After the Burial had more complete songs. And like I said, I'm a sucker for a lot of that melodic guitar work, especially the harmonizations. Mm, yeah. So obviously I was going to lean a little bit more towards the After the Burial side.
It was a lot more traditional metal.
Yeah,
like
it was much more traditional
heavy metal. And I didn't realize until I listened to it. I was like, dude, these guys, those two guitars could hold up to almost any two fucking guitar. Yeah. Whereas,
yeah.
whereas Born of Osiris was more, I think they're more focused on like starting something new, doing something that hadn't been done before. So,
I mean,
fucking props to them for doing something that obviously has been ripped off a lot since then. You know, there's a lot of really like just soulless.
Jesus Christ. Cause the 10 years that preceded this.
Yeah.
Oh
yeah.
My God.
Oh, there was one time that's why like, Djent was a bad word, you know, kind of like same thing, but there's a lot of things like deathcore was a bad word, you know.
It always happens.
It's an oversaturated market,
exactly.
Basically.
They reach like a pinnacle, then people start to hate it, and then it goes back down, and then it always reprises. Yeah. Fucking new metal's coming back now. People are like, let's rap again, you know,
rap again,
you know what I mean?
Make America rap again,
dude. But the same thing, you're exactly right. Even fucking, you know, death metal, black metal, all those, they've all suffered the same thing, and it's kind of sad that happens, but it's very true. Like, once other bands see that something works, or record labels see that something works, they want to copy the recipe, and then you get a bunch of bands who are not as good, but they know how to rip off those parts.
There's a bubble.
Exactly. Yeah. And unfortunately, the Djent parts, you know, they're pretty easy to rip off. You need two notes and you learn a different, like, good, maybe it's still 4/4 time. You're really not changing. You're just changing, like, the polyrhythm, right? Like, so many people can do that. So it's really the drummers who have stepped up to the park, is, or the you have to be a really fucking good drummer to drum in the genre, for sure. Like, there's not a lot of fluff. I mean, there's ways you can cheat it, but still, you know. But like you said, getting back to the point is, I did get oversaturated, but the big band, like, these bands will still be on the, you know, the upper tier. Like, I'd put Bela Maya. Like, I still love ID, and I don't remember the other one with, like, It Ain't Safe to Swim Today. Like, those are good
that
albums.
Was really close. Like, I was thinking of maybe even, like, I was like, Veil of Maya might have been a better matchup for Born of Osiris, but Veil of Maya started a
Or even after the burial, because Mark, is it Mark Okobo?
Yeah.
He plays a lot of, like, melodic shit. Like, you can tell he loved
In Flames.
Honestly,
and dude, he's just the only guitarist, right?
Yes, dude.
He can play. Yeah, he honestly, that sound out of one guitarist is massive. Like, massive,
a lot of sound. What's that? God, I'm trying to think of that song.
It's Not Safe to Swim Today, or the
The one off ID.
Unbreakable.
That breakdown in the, like, that middle breakdown, it ain't right.
That's the part. That's like a vocal part. Now is the time to believe in yourself. Have no fear.
It's good to lose your mind, man.
I remember the first time we saw them. It was In Flames, Trivium, Veil of Maya, and King.
Oh, that's
all together. And I remember watching Veil of Maya. Wasn't a fan, but I remember they played, I think Unbreakable was the last song in the set. And I remember hearing that breakdown, being like, these dudes ain't
That was
like,
impressive.
What the fuck was that?
It did take me a while to get into Veil of Maya, but they won my respect with that album for sure. Yeah. Like, that was their first two albums are, like, incredible. And now I respect what they're doing still, but they add, I'm very picky about my clean vocals, to be honest, you know, and they've added cleans and their new vocals is talented, but I'm just like, I don't know, maybe speaking of clean vocals,
did you like the new Whitechapel album with his clean vocals?
I did too.
The Valley.
Because
I actually really enjoyed it too.
A lot of people were upset about it, but if you can't make the same fucking album again and again. You can't talk about fucking killing hookers for fucking, you know, sex workers. Sex workers is a politically correct term. You can't talk about killing women for all these albums. So they've been kind of moving towards a time period that I wasn't really crazy about, but with The Valley, they just embrace that sort of progress and the cleans. Like, what was the Hickory Creek? Is the like their soft song?
Yep,
that is a great fucking song.
Because
so.
I my thing is that at least he wasn't going outside of his range. Yeah. Like, he has a baritone voice and he sings low, and I thought it fit. And that song specifically, when they get to that breakdown part, I thought that scream, it reminded me of like a Neurosis, like a Scott Kelly, because it was a little bit drier.
Yeah.
A little. So I thought they did a good job, and I thoroughly enjoyed The Valley. And I'm not like a huge Whitechapel fan.
Yeah.
You know, the first time I actually dived into them was when they toured for This Is Exile, because they were touring with BDM, and I was like, well, I might as well listen to it. And I was like,
Why didn't I listen to this sooner? Yeah. Those first two albums are definitely like they helped shape deathcore. They helped popularize sure. And I hope we could talk about those at some point.
We need to do it. We need to do that one. Yep. Like that one against, what's the one from All Shall Perish with Wage Slaves?
Ooh,
that'd be a good battle.
I know which one you're talking about.
Fuck, I can't even.
The Price of Existence.
That
is too nasty.
Yeah.
Too disgusting.
Yeah. Well, anyway, that's the end of the debate today, episode 49. We're going to go off on tangents, but Rareform is the winner. If you think the new Reign is the winner, what's their opinion, JJ?
You're wrong.
You're fucking wrong. Any closing notes, fellas? We got it all out there.
No, we got it all out.
No, only eight songs. I didn't think it would last this long.
Yeah. Well, we did go off some tangents, but they were good.
It's all good.
It doesn't matter. Anyway, guys. Fucking like and subscribe. Keep on headbanging as always.
Peace out, guys.
I know the COVID shit, the concerts aren't going on. Oh. Like I said, invite some people over. Us three, we're about to run a circle pit in the back. You don't fucking think so? We are. Like and subscribe. See you next week, motherfuckers. Keep on headbanging. Peace out.